funding for the Frugal Gourmet has been provided by InSinkErator, makers of the versatile steam and hot dispenser system. For food or beverage preparation that calls for boiling water instantly. InSinkErator, for cooks everywhere.
Additional financial support was provided by viewers like you.
Hi, how are you? Welcome to more talk about our immigrant ancestors. I'm going to have trouble today because I want to talk with you about a culture that is certainly one of my favorites, but it's a culture that has known so much tragedy that I may have trouble with the show. So hang on with me. Now, if you're a Jew, you'll understand, because we're going to talk about Jewish history and certainly Jewish food. That's how you'll find out about what a Jew is. You eat. One of the greatest gifts that the Jews brought us was schmaltz, according to my cook. The first people that came here, called Jews, the first immigrants to America, came in 1654. They were Jews that came from Portugal and established the first synagogue in New Amsterdam, which of course was New York. They were called Sephardic because that means Spanish in medieval Hebrew, but they weren't Spanish at all, they were Portuguese. So 1654, that's only 30 years after the Mayflower. So Jews have been here since the beginning, and they've been immigrating ever since, and I'm glad. They've come from many countries. There's so many countries that it's hard to talk about their source. They've come from Russia, from Poland, from Italy, from Germany, from Spain, from Portugal. And they generally came because they felt persecuted in their homeland. You see, biblically, the Lord of Israel calls the people of Israel chosen. But they were chosen for a special responsibility. It was no honor, for heaven's sakes. I wish the Jews had been honored, but they put up with incredible pain and anguish because people misunderstood what the chosenness meant. That's one reason. I think the other reason was that they put up with religious persecution because they were so bright. They've always been bright. They've been bankers and lawyers and actors and doctors and teachers and musicians since the Middle Ages. And so they were put upon. In 1096, the First Crusade wiped out thousands of Jews, and this went on. By the 1600s, things were just terrible in Europe, and people began to move out, and some of them came here. By the 1800s, many were coming here, coming through Ellis Island, coming into New York City, and many came and began as shopkeepers, little bitty shops. And now we have names that go back to those times, names like Macy's and Altman and Gimbel's and Magnin's. Did you know that? It's important stuff. Then, in the 1940s, it hit. The Great Holocaust hit Europe, in which the Nazis tried to exterminate the Jews. And many fled by 1939 because they could smell what was coming. They came through Ellis Island. Thousands came. And in this picture, 1904, the picture from the 1939 Fortune magazine is labeled "The Ragged Regiments from Europe." What an insulting title! Here were these people who gave up their whole past and came to this country to find a new land. In 1939, there were shops down along the Lower East Side. This is the year of my birth. Look at the place. You know, it's still like that in some ways. Go down to the Lower East Side in New York, you'll find it fascinating. In any case, these people came from countries all over the world, and they came with, well, they wound up with the immigrant problem. What is that? Well, it's you go to a new culture and you feel foreign, so you stay in ghettos in order to speak the language and be with people that you know and understand. Then you have children, and your children go to school, and they feel foreign at school because everybody knows they're from Poland or Czechoslovakia or Germany. And then they come home, and they want mommy and daddy to speak English instead of Poland or Czechoslovakian or German. And mama says, "You're becoming too American." And at school, the kids say, "You're too foreign." So the second generation to arrive here, the generation to be born here, see, feels very foreign. So they want to forget about all of their ties to the old land. And then they have children. Well, those kids don't feel foreign. They don't feel foreign at school. They don't feel foreign with grandma. They don't feel foreign with... As a matter of fact, they like the idea that their parents are Polish or they're German or something. And then it happens. One night, the little kid comes home and he walks in the house and talks to his mama. Mama's second generation. She wants to forget everything. And she says, "Mama, guess what? Grandma's going to teach me Polish." And it's, the Jews say, what the son wants to forget, the grandson wants to remember. And that's how we maintain ethnic identity in America. Certainly the synagogue and the school is terribly important. But the kids felt foreign twice, you see. Actually, they do really have three heritages. Jewish, which is not just a background, it's a mindset, it's a commitment. Secondly, the background from the country which they came, Jews came from everywhere, Germany, as I said, everywhere, you see. So they have a second heritage, and thirdly, they're American. They've got three heritages. I have only two. I think I'm jealous. We should start cooking, but one more thing. In 1945 to 48, the nation of Israel was finally founded. Now, the Jews have not had their own nation since biblical times. They've wandered and wandered and been thrown out of the strangest situations. So now there is a place centering around Jerusalem called Israel, and that is the place where Jews go. But most Jews have come here. America has the largest concentration of Jews anywhere in the world, and we're very lucky. What did they contribute? Are you ready? These are just contemporary Jews, not since the old days. Just listen to this. These are all Jews. Some came from the old country, some were raised here in the Jewish neighborhoods. Al Jolson, Houdini, Jack Benny, Yasha Heifetz, Arthur Rubinstein, Phil Silvers, Bette Midler, Sid Caesar, Albert Einstein, Benny Goodman, Bob Dylan, Barbara Streisand, Isaac Stern, Leonard Bernstein, George Gershwin, the Marx Brothers, Milton Berle, Danny Kaye, Zero Mostel, Arthur Miller, and my dear friend Itzhak Perlman. Now, and there are 1,000 more that you should hear about. But I can take you to a neighborhood where you can meet some Jews who still remember some of the old ways. This is Solomon's Bookstore on Fairfax in Los Angeles. I'm looking at a kiddush cup, which is necessary for your family for the celebration of Seder, the most holy night of the year for Jews. And of course, I found lots of cookbooks. I couldn't miss those. Wonderful Jewish cookbooks. They all have chicken fat. Now, the Eilat Bakery has kosher treats that, oh, look, I'm gonna cry, just look at the beautiful rolled kugels and the cookies and goodies. Oh, they're wonderful places. And the strudels. Now this one is a strictly kosher house in Miami. Lots of Jews in Miami, wonderful place. The front of the case is filled, look at the gefilte fish and the stuffed peppers. Isn't this, and just going, it's all takeout, but it's strictly kosher. That is to say, there are no dairy products in the place. You don't mix up dairy with meat. Now, this is Bob Anderson, the manager. Who, you see, he has his yarmulke on. He always wears his hat at work. You always keep your hat on in the presence of God, absolutely. Corned beef, here he's stuffed peppers getting ready for the case. Now, I asked Mr. Harvey Marmelstein about what's going on.
No, I'm not cooking.
You're not
cooking? They all cook, and I only watch everything. But,
and what do you watch for?
Watch for the kosher label, which should come in the right mm-hmm. place, mm-hmm. which the rabbi okayed. Mm-hmm. And then I watch everything should be in order. Mm-hmm. I mean, this, we make in the fires, because according to Jewish law, it's not permitted for only Jewish people to make the fire for cooking.
Only you can light the fire?
Yeah.
I see. No goy can light the fire?
No.
How fascinating.
Yeah. He could cook, but he has to light the fire.
Where were you born and raised?
In Czechoslovakia.
Czechoslovakia?
Yeah.
How long have you been here in Miami?
Oh, I'm here since 1949.
1949.
Now, this is Greg, who's making some knishes, but I must tell you that Harvey Marmelstein, the man you just met, is a mashgiach. He's been trained, rabbinically trained, to be sure that everything is pure and according to kosher law. And look at Greg. He's a terrific pastry maker. He's making knishes, and he's a goy. You know what that means? It means that he's not a Jew. That's all. Well, look at him go. I couldn't believe how fast this kid is. Look at these. Sure takes me a long time to make a good knish. Isn't it wonderful? Now, you can get some good Jewish foods in the front to take out. I had to get some chopped liver. I simply couldn't stand it any longer. Wonderful, wonderful stuff. Now, if you want to go have a lunch on the table instead of takeout, I suggest a wonderful place in Los Angeles called Cantor's. The food is just, well, you won't believe this. Channing is having lunch with me. And the sandwiches, everything we ordered, come so quickly. They're so good. Look at the selection. That's Harold's Triple Decker. You can see a corned beef sandwich, lox, herring, potato pancakes, chopped liver, matzo ball soup, and pickles. Can we eat it all? Is it possible? I was trying to decide.
Oh, no. Thank you. No way.
Listen, this is Mr. Cantor, and he had to take Craig and I to see the bakery as well. Talk about a man who's proud of his place. It's just wonderful, wonderful food and delicious eating. You can get down there and go. New York has them. Los Angeles has them. San Francisco has a few. Most of the rest of us are pretty desperate. Chicago has a couple that are really good kosher places where you can go stuff. Let me show you how to stuff. Today, I'm going to show you some quick dishes that are very basic because in the old days, you practically lived on grains and noodles. So here's a quickie. We have a cup of groats. It's called kasha. Put about a cup of groats in a hot pan. There we go. See that? It's chopped up buckwheat called kasha. Old classic Jewish dish. Now, get the pan hot and then stir into that one egg. And you stir it around, one cup and then one egg, and stir that around until all the kasha is coated. And then cook it over medium heat until, well, I'll show you, until it dries out. And you have the grain, you see, absorbs, here it is, the grain absorbs it wasn't supposed to be sticky. Are you surprised? Just cook it for a little bit until everything falls apart. It absorbs the egg, you see? Now into that, we're going to add a couple cups of chicken stock. Now have it boiling first, and you'll get, mine isn't boiling, but my pan isn't hot, so what do you care? It'll be boiling, and then you add 2 cups of chicken stock to 1 cup of kasha. Let that simmer for about, 8 minutes or so. And then you stir in the varnishkas. This is kasha varnishkas. What are varnishkas? Varnishkas are little bow ties. They're pasta bow ties. What are you having? Grain with grain? That's what we used to eat down on the Lower East Side in 1939. That's right. You can buy these in any market, and they're little bitty bow ties, you see? So cook up about a cup of these. Cook up a cup fresh, you see? Boil them in water until they're just barely, not quite what I would call tender, al dente. That's not a Yiddish word, but then what's the difference? And we'll stir this is cooked up now. We'll stir the bow ties into the pot and then add some onions and chicken fat. Onions cooked in chicken fat. That's just a must in the... I know it's high in cholesterol. I know it's terrible for you, but if you're going to do this kind of cooking, do it once in a while and do it properly, please. Stir in some onion seeds. I just sautéed them. And then you want to add a little salt and pepper to this and get it ready to serve. I have a dish ready for you. I love this stuff. It is very basic, that's true. Whoops, it's in the oven. I hope. Yes, it is. Oh, there's so many good smells. I have some stuffed peppers in here. Just terrific stuff. And this is what you call kasha varnishkas. Kasha with little ties. It's really kind of a cute dish, isn't it? Put some out for you, and we'll go on to some others. I have another one that's nothing but noodles. Why? Well, in the old days, when you didn't have any money, you had to eat grains and noodles, dishes that were popular in the old days when you were living in some other culture, and you helped your children remember who they are by eating the old dishes. So what happens when the kids grow up? The second generation says, I don't like kasha varnishkas. I don't like kasha varnishkas. I don't want to eat it. Reminds me too much of the foreignness I felt when I was a kid. But the grandson stops off every Wednesday at grandma's house on the way home from school because she's going to make kasha with bow ties for him. And then you remember, you see? That's how it goes. And that's how it must go. All right, secondly, this one is strange. It's called a noodle kugel. If you've never tried a noodle kugel, I feel sorry for you. Cook up 1 cup of milk, 1 pound of cream cheese, and about a half a stick of butter into a nice rich sauce. You see this? Isn't that gorgeous? Oh, it looks almost like sour cream. It's even richer than sour cream because of the butter. Now, into my bowl, I'm going to put some, about a pound of pre-cooked, barely cooked noodles. And these noodles, let's see. I have some here, so here we are. These are simply white egg noodles. Basic to the Jewish kitchen. Add the sauce to the noodles. And then we're going to add... Now, you're going to laugh at me, but you need a tablespoon of chicken fat. I should probably have blended this into pan, but I'll just show you the ingredients. Put in a tablespoon of chicken fat. This is incredible. It adds a wonderful richness. Now we're gonna add sugar, and you can say, wait a minute, what is chicken fat that's sweet taste like? Well, it's wonderful. I want about 5 tablespoons of sugar. This is a dessert dish of sorts. I guess we're gonna call it that. And some lemon peel, and grated lemon peel and orange peel, right off the old lemon and the orange. I have a little bit of each, you see. Do that strictly to taste. And then we need to add some eggs, and I have 4 eggs stirred up. There we go. Now blend all of this together. It might be easier for you to blend the eggs and the spices in the pan, but I don't want the cream and the milk to be hot, because otherwise you'll cook your eggs. You know what I mean? So let that sauce cool. Stir all of this up. Goes into a baking pan, and we're gonna bake it. Let me show you here. I've got a topping I wanna put on this too. I think I'll have time. There we go. A buttered baking dish. Should be about 9 by 13. I think this one's gonna be a little bit small. Sometimes even I run out of pots and pans and cooking gear. Boy, this is gonna, I'm pushing it. No, I think I'm all right. Now here's the fun part. On the top of this, don't laugh at me now. You watch closely. On the top of this, I'm going to put, we're talking Brooklyn cooking now. Brooklyn cooking. I've got to be respectful because my wife is from Brooklyn, you see? So we've got to be respectful here. On the top of this, we're going to put a little bit of, are you ready? Wheaties. Wheaties breakfast. Or you can use cornflakes. Or you can just bake this. An Orthodox cook would say, don't be silly, you should just bake it. Just bake it until it gets very crunchy and brown on top. But I like this. I think it's fun. And we're going to mix up, just crush some of these down, you see, and about a cup or so, and then mix it with some brown sugar, 3 or 4 tablespoons. Mix all of that up. There it is. And sprinkle this on top. And you're going to get a crusty, well, just terrific. Then we're going to pour some butter over that. Hold it. Did you hear me? Butter along with chicken fat, along with cream, along with, I cooked with Mr. Itzhak Perlman, the famous violinist, one day, and he said, I know it's heart attack, but he said, it's so sweet. He says, just do it. Well, you be careful, because all of us have to cut down on butter fat and the cream and all that sort of thing, and chicken fat. So once in a while you make this, but not often, or I'll get you. Once in a while you have to have a feast, right? You splurge. I don't like dieting. Of course, I've never tried it. Put this in a 350 oven for about an hour or so, and this is what you'll get. Where did I put it? Here he is. Too hot to handle. Here he is. Noodle kugel. You got that? Noodle kugel. I've covered it. Leave it uncovered when you're baking it, but I've tried to keep mine warm, see? So I put some aluminum on it, but you don't need that. Isn't that gorgeous? It's just, oh, it's crunchy. Serve it for dessert. I know Jewish families that serve this as a course, because Jews like sweet things in the middle of the meal. Part of the Seder and part of the New Year's festival involves eating bitter things along with sweet things. So you'll have a sweet wine along with a bitter, because you've got to remember that life is bittersweet. Don't lie to your children. Don't tell them that someday they're going to be just happy, because happiness is hard work. So it's bittersweet. Jews know that better than anyone. There's an old saying, the Jews say, because they've been in so much trouble in the world, they've had so much pain, they say, with every bit of joy there comes a little anxiety, because they're afraid something's going to happen, you see. Bittersweet. So you have a sweet dish along with a sour dish. Part of the tradition, and I think it's a great tradition, because they know more about reality than just almost any other culture I know. A quickie, I hope. I have a dish I'm just going to show you. It is called eggs of barley, and it's here. Here we go. Here it is. I better mix this up first. Forgot that I hadn't. Here's what I've cooked. This is an interesting dish of a pasta that looks like little barley pieces, but it's not barley at all. You cook up about a couple cups of this stuff, and then boil it in water. I boil mine in chicken stock because I love it that way. And then I'm going to add to that. Here we go again. Give me some onions cooked in a little bit of chicken fat. Stir this in. And we're going to add some mushrooms that I've sauteed. Yes, in butter fat or chicken fat. Yes, you can use margarine. I'm not sure margarine's that much better for you. Honest to goodness, I'm not. I just want you to cut down on fat. If you have to go to margarine, I don't know what you're going to gain. A little bit of salt and pepper, not too much, and we'll stir that up. And we have what they call egg barley, because it's an egg noodle product made to look like barley, and you serve it with mushroom and onion. Oh, this is served very hot and very delicious on the kosher table. It's very beautiful. I shouldn't say kosher because I've violated a couple of rules here. If you have beef on the table, then you can't use cream or butter because there's a rule supposedly also involving health, but I think it's primarily a matter of your understanding that you must treat the world in a humane manner. So what you do is to never cook an animal in the milk of its mother. So you would never make a stew and put milk in it, beef stew with cream in it, you see. Never. On the other hand, you can use chicken fat. That's a different creature. And it helps you remember that that you're dependent upon God's creation. You see, when the Lord of Israel created everything, why, the rules that go with our enjoying creation help us understand that we're totally dependent. That's what it means. That's what it means. There we go. That's just a great dish. I've got so many dishes around here, I can't believe it. All right, now, I have, knishes. I'm not going to have time to show you how to roll one. You saw Bob do it. But I do want you to see how thin the dough should be. Let me put this one out. The dough should be like so. See how thin that is? Isn't that beautiful? And then you just roll it up. I just don't have time to roll some. But we have done some. Matter of fact, I'll not take credit for these. Craig, my cook, did these. And he's got a whole pan full. Craig, will you dish these up, please? They're in the bottom oven, I think. And there's a plate right there on the bottom for them. Okay? Terrific. All right, and in the meantime, let's see, what's next? Can you believe all of this? Oh, are you ready? Chopped liver. The chopped liver is very necessary to a kosher household. There it is. You got room?
Sure.
Okay. And then we want to serve Irving's cucumber salad. Now, Irving's cucumber salad is like everybody else's cucumber salad, except that Irving puts a little shot of mustard seed and some dill seed in his, and it's really, I think it's a serious improvement. I just love the stuff. And then we have some stuffed peppers. I'll dish some of these up for you. They're simply green peppers that have been stuffed with a mixture of hamburger, a little bit of garlic. Oh, gotcha on that one. I just heard a cook in Miami yell, "No garlic in that dish." Well, I like it with garlic. I love it with garlic. So let's dish these up, Craig, and we'll get on to the last of the dishes here. Can you get them into the pan here?
Sure.
I've got so much going on. And then we have, boy, we're going to just kill each other here today.
Well, it's dangerous out here.
This is how the grandma's house looks like at a holiday. This is what a Jewish grandma's for. She cooks until the stuff's almost beyond belief. Okay, you fix those up. Don't put the sauce on yet. I want to show you about that. I talked about that.
Okay.
Here's one from Fanny Silverstein's cookbook. Oh, I love her. She's a gorgeous woman. Honey cake. And it's this is so rich. It's not as heavy as it looks. It's worse. No, it's not. It's really delicious stuff. And finally, a good cheesecake. You can't celebrate anything in New York without a cheesecake. After all, this goes way back. How you doing?
Super.
Now, what kind of sauce are we going to put on this?
Well, just a simple tomato sauce.
Okay.
Just saute a little onion, some garlic.
Onion, garlic?
Some fresh tomato.
Okay.
And a little canned tomato sauce.
All right, you want to put that on?
And what's going to make this a little unique is a little bit of vinegar, and that'll add some sharpness to it, and it's a great complement for the peppers.
Or lemon juice.
Sure.
I bet that would work, too. Okay. There it is. I talked too long. I didn't get to show you all the steps for the food. Your kreplach, terrific. Your knishes are terrific.
Knishes.
But the point I've tried to make today is that Jews have been with us since the very beginning, and to this day, there are people in our culture who want to think of them as foreigners. That's bizarre. That's not even possible. There's nothing foreign about the Jews. They belong to us since the beginning. And they're one of those ethnic groups that continue to teach their children not only about theology, not only about biblical traditions, but about the meaning of their own personal history. And it's done with food. That's one of the major methods. Let me get these tomatoes out here. We can see this. Tomatoes have just covered the stuffed peppers. Look at that. Isn't that incredible? All right, the dishes. Aside from the schmaltz, I don't have to rehearse that one for you. The dishes that we've done today, then, in order to help us remember about Jewish history, are potato-filled knishes, potato and onion-filled, a honey cake from Fanny, bow ties with buckwheat groats, chopped liver, this is Mr. Perlman's favorite, and wonderful noodle kugel, delicious dish, you wouldn't believe it. The orange peel and lemon peel really do the job. A cheesecake, I have to admit this is my wife's recipe, she was raised in Brooklyn. Egg barley with mushrooms and onions. And finally, there's some meat on the table. This is hamburger stuffed green peppers and Irving's cucumber salad. It's Jewish, it belongs to us. It's American, it's wonderful. Until I see you again, whoops, here it is. Until I see you again, this is the Frugal Gourmet. L'chaim! I bid you peace. Bye-bye.
Funding for the Frugal Gourmet has been provided by InSinkErator, inventors of the food waste disposer, the convenient kitchen appliance that eliminates food waste immediately. InSinkErator, for cooks everywhere.
Additional financial support was provided by viewers like you.
This is PBS.
Jeff Smith's unique collection of ethnic recipes is available to you in his book, The Frugal Gourmet on Our Immigrant Ancestors. Call 1-800-541-4100 to charge your copy or order by mail. The book contains Jeff Smith's personal selection of over 400 recipes from 35 different ethnic groups that immigrated to America and is available for $19.95. Call the number on your screen to charge your order or request a mail order form to receive a copy of The Frugal Gourmet on Our Immigrant Ancestors.
Hi, this is Martin Yan with an invitation to an Asian banquet that lasts 9 whole days. My first culinary tour to Hong Kong was so much fun that I'm going back in September. Join me and cooking expert Joyce Ju as we explore the land of nine dragons with street market tours, cooking classes, and then is off to Bangkok, Thailand for sightseeing and plenty of spicy cuisine. Our culinary adventure to Asia's most exciting cities leaves September the 18th. And includes fantastic dining, airfare, and hotels. Everything but your appetite.
Join Martin Yan on an incredible Asian adventure. For more information, call 1-800-292-1238.